Well, good morning and welcome to St. Peter's on this, the sixth Sunday of Easter. Happy Mother's Day. So let us stand and worship God as we sing Hail to the Lord's Anointed. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Christ is risen. Hallelujah. Is risen indeed. Hallelujah. Those who love me will keep my word, Jesus promises, and my Father will love them, and we will come to them and make our home with them. Let us pray. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul, and with all your mind, and with all your strength. Jesus said, this is the great and first commandment. And a second is like it, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Christ was raised from the dead that we might walk in newness of life. Let us receive new life in him as we confess our sins in penitence and faith. Merciful God, our Maker and our Judge, we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, and in what we have failed to do. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. We repent and are sorry for all our sins. Father, forgive us. Strengthen us to love and obey you in newness of life. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, who has promised forgiveness to all who turn to him in faith, pardon you and set you free from all your sins. Strengthen you in all goodness and keep you in eternal life. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Brothers and sisters, let's pray together the prayer of the day. Let us pray. Ever-living God, who called your church to witness that you were in Christ reconciling the world to yourself, help us so to proclaim the good news of your love, that all who hear it may be reconciled to you, through him who died and rose again and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated for the readings.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Then Paul stood in front of the Areopagus and said, "Athenians, I see how extremely spiritual you are in every way. For as I went through the city and looked carefully at the objects of your worship, I found among them an altar with the inscription, 'To an unknown God.' What therefore you worship as unknown, this I proclaim to you, the God who made the world and everything, and everything in it, he who is Lord of heaven and earth, does not live in shrines made by human hands, nor is he served by human hands as though he needed anything, since he himself gives to all mortals life and breath and all things. From one ancestor, he made all peoples to inhabit the whole earth, and he allotted the times of their existence and the boundaries of the places where they would live, so that they would search for God and perhaps fumble about for him and find him, though indeed he is not far from each one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being. Or even some of your own poets have said, for we too are his offspring. Since we are God's offspring, we ought not to think that the deity is like gold or silver or stone, an image formed by the art and imagination of mortals. While God has overlooked the times of human ignorance, now he commands all people everywhere to repent, because he has fixed a day on which he will have the world judged in righteousness by a man whom he has appointed. And of this he has given assurance to all by raising him from the dead. For the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. I will read the psalm to the colon, and we all speak the printing in dark letters. Come and see what God has done. He is awesome in his deeds among mortals. He turned the sea into dry land. They passed through the river on foot. There we rejoiced in him who rules by his might forever. His eyes keep watch on the nations. Let the rebellious not exalt themselves. Bless our God, O peoples. Let the sound of his praise be heard, who has kept us among the living and has not let our feet slip. For you, O God, have tested us. You have tried us as silver is tried. You brought us into the net. You laid burdens on our backs. You let people ride over our heads. We went through fire and through water. Yet you have brought us out to a spacious place. I will come into your house with burnt offerings. I will pay you my vows, those that my lips uttered and my mouth promised when I was in trouble. Come and hear, all you who fear God, and I will tell you what he has done for me. I cried aloud to him, and he was extolled with my tongue. If I had cherished iniquity in my heart, the Lord would not have listened. But truly God has listened. He has heard the words of my prayer. A reading from the first letter of Peter. Finally, all of you have unity of spirit, sympathy, love for one another, a tender heart and a humble mind. Do not repay evil for evil or abuse for abuse, but on the contrary, repay with a blessing. It is for this that you were called, that you might inherit a blessing. For those who desire to love life and to see good days, let them keep their tongues from evil and their lips from speaking deceit. Let them turn away from evil and do good. Let them seek peace and pursue it. For the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are open to their prayer. But the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. Now who will harm you if you are eager to do what is good? But even if you do suffer for doing what is right, you are blessed. Do not fear what they fear, and do not be intimidated, but in your hearts sanctify Christ as Lord. Always be ready to make your defence to anyone who demands from you an accounting for the hope that is in you. Yet do it with gentleness and respect. Maintain a good conscience so that when you are maligned, those who abuse you for your good conduct in Christ may be put to shame. For it is better to suffer for doing good, if suffering should be God's will, than to suffer for doing evil. For Christ also suffered for sins once for all, the righteous for the unrighteous, in order to bring you to God. He was put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit, in which also he went and made a proclamation to the spirits in prison, who in former times did not obey, when God waited patiently in the days of Noah during the building of the ark, in which a few, that is, eight lives, were saved through water. And baptism, which this prefigured, now saves you, not as a removal of dirt from the body, but as an appeal to God for a good conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God, with angels, authorities, and powers made subject to him. For the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Our gradual hymn this morning, Thou Whose Almighty Word. Hallelujah, hallelujah. All who love me keep my words, and my Father will love them, and we will come to them. Hallelujah. The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. Luke. Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus said, "If you love me, you will keep my commandments. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to be with you forever. This is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him because he abides with you, and he will be in you. I will not leave you orphaned. I am coming to you. In a little while, the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. On that day, you will know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. They who have my commandments and keep them are those who love me. And those who love me will be loved by my Father. And I will love them and reveal myself to them. For the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. The Lord be with you. Please be seated. Anglicans, we're the real deal, aren't we? One of you said to me this week, Anglicans, we're the real deal, aren't we? Last Saturday's coronation service liturgy opened with the words, "The kingdom of God is not a place, but a way of being, a reign of justice, mercy, and love, which Jesus came to bring." King of Kings is a title that is given to Jesus in the Bible. Christians profess the belief that he reigns forever as King of Kings and of Lord of Lords. Behind the pageantry of the coronation service, the King commits himself to follow the Lord he serves in a life of loving service in his role as monarch. Like the funeral of the late Queen Elizabeth, the coronation of King Charles was a clarion call to this world, that the kingdom of God is in fact something that concerns us all, our contemporary world, that the lordship of God is the relation of God's own reality to us and to this world. The coronation service began with a child welcoming the new king. Your Majesty, as children of the kingdom of God, we welcome you in the name of the King of Kings. The king then brought himself and the whole congregation, which was much of the world, before God in silent prayer to remind the world before whom it stands, the God who made the world and everything in it, in whom we live and move and have our being, who has revealed himself once for all to the world in Jesus Christ, the Messiah of God, who has come with mercy and healing in his wings. Lord, have mercy indeed. There followed the presentation of the Bible, the heart of Christian worship, and of our social and cultural heritage, with the words, "Sir, to keep you mindful of the law and the gospel of God as the rule for the whole life and of government, receive this Bible, the most valuable thing that this world affords, for here is wisdom. This is the royal law. These are the lively oracles of God." The Christian ethic, the love of God, the love of neighbour, is a universal ethic, or it is not Christian. It is God's ethic. It is for the world. It stands above so-called human ethics, whether secular liberal or atheist socialism, as high as the heavens stand above the earth. And the setting aside of this ethic and of the Christian faith behind it, of faith in the God above and his authority, may be the reason for the decline we see throughout Western society today. The Archbishop of Canterbury then led the King in taking the oath, "Your Majesty, will you to the utmost of your power maintain the laws of God and the true profession of the gospel? Will you maintain and preserve inviolably the church its doctrine, worship, discipline, and government? Will you, to the utmost of your power, cause God's law and justice in mercy to be executed in all your judgments? To which the king replied, I will. I solemnly promise to do so. Your average political theorists of the modern era since Machiavelli have reduced the question of political order to the question of power. But Anglicanism is not your average political theorist. To quote Shakespeare, it is above that sceptred sway. Anglicans understand more deeply than do our contemporaries the truth of Augustine's dictum that there can be no social peace where there is not the proper and true worship of God publicly. That there can be no unity of society where there is not the true religion. There can be no harmony without the presence of the Spirit of God. So that Jesus says to us in his gospel this morning, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to be with you forever. This is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees nor knows him. But you know him, because he abides with you, and he will be in you. I will not leave you orphaned. I am coming to you. As Anglicans, we understand that when society keeps faith in its God, God keeps faith in its society. This is God's covenant. Those who love me will keep my word, and my Father will love them, and we will come to them and make our home with them. Notice the we here. To the open societies of the Christian West, not just Jesus, but the Holy Spirit has come to them and made their home with them, has kept them safe to bless them, to prosper them, so that the world may know the reality of God, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. The kingdom of God that is a concrete monarchy of the Father in heaven through the Son who is raised on high to rule over all kings in this world and in the power of the Spirit that is the force field of history and the human race itself. So a Christian human monarch is there to witness not to themselves, as the order of service and the life of Elizabeth makes clear, but to the one who is above them, as high as the heaven is above the earth. And not just monarchs, the God's gift to the world through the English people is in fact the English Reformation. For it is there that the principle of liberty became the basis of Western society. God's gift to his world. The fullest realization of Christian freedom and of human freedom the world has ever seen. The monarchy of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit is the power that has shaped our Western history and culture, and that is the source of our every freedom. This principle of liberty stands against tyranny everywhere. And it is this Western society that has stood against the tyranny of Vladimir Putin. You don't need Christianity until you do. For freedom Christ has set us free, the apostle said. Do not submit again to a yoke of slavery. Yet the ambiguity of the liberal secular conception of freedom, that you don't need God, means that God's judgment has fallen here too, with the rise of atheist socialism in our day. Aimed as it is at the return of modern society, the whole of society, back to its roots in Christianity from whence it came, this judgment has salvation in mind, the salvation of all people, the freedom of all people, and not just in the West, but throughout the world where people live under the tyranny of authoritarianism, China, Russia. This is still the hour of liberty. For the full realization of the principle of liberty throughout the Western common cultural life. But if Western culture does not rediscover its roots in Christianity, then people, and especially the young, will cry out for socialism, for they will no longer be able to bear the meaningless of a modern secular order. But they do not have to, because Jesus Christ has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God, where he reigns with angels and authorities and powers, that is, political orders, premiers, prime ministers, made subject to him. He has come with freedom in his wings. As we heard in the coronation gospel on Saturday, the words of Jesus himself. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me to preach good news to the poor, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, to open the prison door to them that are bound, to give them beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning, a garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor, the day of justice and peace of our God. The kingdom of God is not a place but a way of being, a reign of justice, mercy, and love which Jesus came to bring. King of kings, Lord of lords, Jesus reigns forever at the right hand of the Father. And his Holy Spirit he pours out upon a whole society, that it might be a light to this world, a city on a hill, the light to all the nations of this world. Like the funeral of Queen Elizabeth, the coronation of King Charles was the clarion call to this world. The kingdom of God is something that actually concerns us and our contemporary world and all who live in it. The lordship of God is the actual relation of the reality of God himself to us and to the world. The Lord be with you. So let us pray for the world and for the church. And the response to the refrain, Lord, in your mercy, is, hear our prayer. Jesus, our exalted Lord, has been given all authority. Let us seek his intercession before the Father, that our prayers may be perfected by his prayer. Jesus Christ, a great high priest living forever to intercede for us, pray for the church, your broken body in the world. Lord, in your mercy. Amen. Jesus Christ, King of righteousness, enthroned at the right hand of the Majesty on high, pray for the world and make it subject to your gentle rule. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, enthroned in heavenly splendor, look with favor upon your servant Charles, our King, and bestow upon him such gifts of wisdom and love that we and all people may live in peace and prosperity and in loving service one to another. Lord, in your mercy. Hear our prayers, O Lord, and so direct and support your servant, King Charles, that he may not bear the sword in vain, but may use it as the minister of God to resist evil and defend the good. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty Lord, everlasting God, vouchsafe to direct, sanctify and govern our hearts, minds and bodies in the ways of your laws and in the works of your commandments, that through your most mighty protection, both here and ever, we may be preserved in body, mind and soul. Lord, in your mercy. Jesus Christ, Son of Man, drawing humanity into the life of God, pray for your sisters and brothers in need, distress and sorrow. Lord, in your mercy. Jesus, pioneer of our salvation, bringing us to glory through your death and resurrection, surround with your saints and angels those who have died trusting in your promises. Lord, in your mercy. Jesus Christ, Lord over all things, ascended far above the heavens and filling the universe, pray for us who receive the gifts you give us for work in your service. Lord, in your mercy. Jesus Christ, our good shepherd, drawing us into the life of God, we pray especially this morning for all or any who may be on our hearts or our minds in the silence this morning. Lord, in your mercy. As we pray especially for April and Ken, Trevor, Prue, Val, Andrew W., Max Wern, Andrea, for Jane and Enid, for Stephanie. Lord, in your mercy. Jesus Christ, keep the church in the unity of the Spirit and in the bond of peace. And bring the whole created order to worship at your feet. We ask all of these things in your name. For you are alive and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please stand for the blessing. For the risen Christ came and stood among his disciples and said, "Peace be with you." Then were they glad when they saw the Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah. The peace of the risen Christ be always with you. So let us turn to one another and offer the sign of peace.
Thank you.
unbounded joy, we offer you our sacrifice of praise. As we are fed with the bread of heaven, may we know your resurrection power. Through Jesus Christ, our risen Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Almighty and Eternal Father. And on this day of our redemption, to celebrate with joyful hearts the memory of your wonderful work. For by the mystery of his passion, Jesus Christ, your risen Son, has conquered the powers of death and evil, and has restored in men and women the image of your glory. He has placed them once more in paradise, and has opened to them the gate of life eternal. And so in the joy of this Passover, earth and heaven resound with gladness, while angels and archangels and the powers of all creation sing forever the hymn of your glory. Of time was come, you sent your Son to be born of Mary, bright image of your glory. He learnt obedience to you in all things, even to death on a cross, breaking the power of evil, freeing us from sin, putting death to flight. You raised him from death, exalting him to glory, and the new day has dawned. On the night he was betrayed, your Son, Jesus Christ, shared food with his friends, his companions on the way. And while at table, he took bread, blessed, and broke it, and giving it to them, said, "Take, eat, this is my body." After supper, Jesus took a cup of wine, and giving you thanks, he gave it to them and said, "This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for many. Do this in remembrance of me."
Christ has died. Christ is risen.
Therefore, living God, as we obey his command, we remember his life of obedience to you, his suffering and death, his resurrection and exaltation, and his promise to be with us forever. For with this bread and this cup, we celebrate his saving death until he comes. Accept, we pray, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving of our very selves. Send your Holy Spirit upon us and upon this celebration, that we may eat and drink at your table the body and blood of our Lord, our Saviour, and our God, Jesus Christ, the King of kings and the Lord of lords. As one body and one holy people, may we proclaim the everlasting gospel of Jesus Christ, our living Lord, through whom, with whom, and in whom, in the unity and the power of the Holy Spirit, all glory is yours, eternal God, now and forever.
Blessing and honor, glory and
Rejoicing in God's new creation as our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. And we who are many are one body, for we all share in the one bread. The holy gifts of God for the holy people of God. Come, let us take this holy sacrament of the body and blood of Christ in remembrance that he died for us and feed on him in our hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Come, for all is now ready. Thank you. Let us pray. God of life, who for our redemption gave your only begotten Son to the death of the cross, and by whose glorious resurrection have delivered us from the power of our enemy, grant us so to die daily to sin, that we may evermore live with him in the joy of his risen life. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let us pray. A prayer for Mother's Day from Anselm in the year 1109. Jesus, like a mother, you gather your people to you. You are gentle with us as a mother with her children. Despair turns to hope through your sweet goodness. Through your gentleness, we find comfort in fear. Your warmth gives life to the dead. Your touch makes sinners righteous. Lord Jesus, in your mercy, heal us. In your love and tenderness, remake us. In your compassion, bring grace and forgiveness. For the beauty of heaven, may your love prepare us. Amen. Father, thank you for the love of our mothers. Thank you for their care and concern. Thank you for the joys they have shared with us. Thank you for the pains they have borne for us and at times with us. Thank you for all that they have given us. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. The church is one foundation. Hallelujah, Christ is risen.
He is risen.
God the Father, by whose love Christ was raised from the dead, open to you the gates of everlasting life. God the Son, who in bursting from the grave has won a glorious victory, give you joy as you share the Easter faith. And God the Holy Spirit, who filled the disciples with the life of the risen Lord, empower you and fill you with Christ's peace. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. With the risen life of Christ within you, go in peace, to love and to serve the Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah. In the name of Christ, hallelujah, hallelujah.
I didn't fall over.